Hi, everyone. So the Elon Musk comparison was fun. Big shoes to fill. I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey through a couple of decades of technology. I started life as a, well, not life, but I started kind of as a hardware hacker. Ended up as a venture capitalist. I did, by the way, kiteboard with Elon Musk, so he is a friend. I started as a, I was trained as an electrical engineer to design computer chips. And I was so drawn to all the activity in Silicon Valley that I moved out there in this era, right at the tail end of that era. What you see there is something called the Homebrew Computer Club. And it was basically a community of people that were interested in electronic stuff. And there were a lot of interesting young people, a little bit older than me, but young people that you can see up there, Bill Gates, Paul Allen, Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniak, Alan Shugart that started Seagate, the guys that started Sun Microsystems, Nolan Bushnell that started Atari, all showing up to compare thoughts and ideas with little tiny pieces of silicon on pieces of wood with wires that would eventually become what we know today as the modern day microcomputer. Those silicon chips primarily came from a handful of companies. Silicon Valley is called Silicon Valley primarily because of this company. Fairchild Semiconductor is the root of a lot of these things, which you see there's sort of a family tree of a bunch of companies that came out of it. Big companies like Intel or National or AMD, LSI Logic, which is the startup I joined that was formed by the CEO of Fairchild when he wanted to start a new company. I joined him, the company hit, and then you know, back to Jason Hsu's talk about Taiwan as a source for innovation that can be important at world scale. I came back here, at the startup of this company. I wasn't there for very long, but I helped the government basically put together a little bit of a spreadsheet plan for what became Fab 1 at TSMC. I had no idea, honestly, that it would become what it would become, but when Alex earlier today asked if anybody had a phone here, I'll bet that 30 to 50% of the silicon in every one of your phones was made at this company. It's proof that people of Taiwan can be important at world scale. That company also led to this. So Alex referred to a time when I helped put together some internet stuff over here. It was the first industrial scale commercial internet provider. There was there were little academic projects like HiNet and SeedNet that I think are still in existence. I had a project in the USA where I had funded a silicon company to make a chip you basically would describe with a digital file, a very big thing that was a lot of data, and to get it made, you would have to put it in a big tin can, like a movie reel, fly it across the ocean, land at Taoyuan Airport, drive a couple hours down to Hsinchu and drop it off. And at that point in time, which was around 93, 94, the internet was just starting to become usable, and there were FTP programs, and it just bothered me that it literally was at like a two-day process to get this file over on a mag tape. So instead, I ended up buying four routers, and I ended up talking to what was then Ministry of Post and Telecommunications, MPT, that had a division called DGT, which was their data division, and over a period of about a year and a half, convinced them to let me put routers into the infrastructure of their phone company and set up a backhaul to the United States and set up the first commercial, kind of big commercial internet. And you'll see it was, I set it up here in Taiwan. It's the first one on the list. That became an expansion point for all the other countries that we set up. So over time, I ended up with a network, and you can see Taiwan is a little bit of a regional hub, but we set up internet in more than a dozen countries and then ended up building data centers in about 10 of them that went public through Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, Solomon Brothers in 2000 as a data center company. Those two things, so one of them was basically in the silicon world, moving atoms around, physical things, silicon. The internet was about moving bits. Those two pieces together lead us to where we are today. So Jason talked about this transformative thing, blockchain, Bitcoin, what have you, about 10 years ago, 10 years ago in a month, Satoshi Nakamoto, if there is such a person, came out with a paper describing a peer-to-peer currency. Shortly after that, I was mining and being the hardware hacker that I am, this is my dining room. So over a period of time, our house literally became unusable because it was essentially, because I had silicon background and data center background, part of my house was a data center. That has become this. So if you haven't, I thought it'd be useful to just show what a Bitcoin mining data center looks like. I ended up funding a company called BitFury. It is one of the largest Bitcoin mining operations in the world now. And this is what a data center looks like. And this is actually what it sounds like on the inside. They're very loud. Okay, so what you see here is one of our buildings in Iceland. This particular building burns about 10 million watts of electricity. We have three of those in Iceland, and we have similar facilities in Norway, had one in Finland, Azerbaijan, Republic of Georgia, and a few other countries. And these things are basically the machines that run specifically the Bitcoin blockchain. So you can think of these a little bit like routers on the internet. So when you send an email, they basically pass through a bunch of machines that are carrying that message from point A to point B, or when you look on Google to get to a web page. Those bits are basically flowing, going from one spot to another. Those machines there are basically tracking the movement of every Bitcoin. You know, so if Alex sent a Bitcoin to her, then as it moves around, it's basically passed along and written down in multiple places so that there's a redundant database that can't be erased. So that can be used for transactions like a Bitcoin. It can also be used for digital cats, like CryptoKitties, or pieces of electricity, like Power Ledger, or other tokens, like AirSwap. So there's lots of different things that you can encapsulate in a digital envelope, whether it's a piece of value, an identity, a digital cat, or anything else. So it's very transformational. So we're going from basically steering electrons to steering information to steering assets. So when people talk about, you know, the value of what blockchain can bring, if you think about a magnificent, wonderfully big company like Google, which is basically, you know, kind of organizing the world's information, blockchain has the opportunity to essentially organize the world's assets. So if you think about the scale of what's the value of all the world's assets versus the pile of electricity, it's quite a large opportunity in front of us, and we're right at the start. You can think of the transfer of assets as the same thing that has happened over the entirety of recorded human history. So if you want a perspective that is kind of interesting for a look at the past, this is a wonderful book. This is a book by author Neil Ferguson, The Ascent of Money. And he basically traces the history of value exchange in humanity back to the beginning, from pebbles and shells and feathers, all the way to credit default swaps. And as you read about what people have used to transact value for thousands and thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of years, you'll find that what's happening today with blockchain and cryptocurrency is actually no different. It's carried a little bit differently, but it's not that different. I'm going to give you an example. So what you see there is a map of colonial United States. United States has been around a couple hundred years. If you think about the formation of the United States, and as people got off their ships and walked around on the land and drew little lines around the forest to divine states like New York and Virginia and Vermont or what have you, typically those states had some commonalities. Each of the members of the states had a similar viewpoint. They were either religiously or language, you know, identified, and they were willing to trust and transact. Every single one of them came up with their own currency. And over time, it united to the US dollar. But the US dollar is an interesting thing because it's a little bit of an anomaly. The US dollar sort of exists today as a result of what happened at the end of World War II. So picture the scenario where, clock back, you know, 40, 50 years, all of the industrial nations are wiped out except the USA. You have 100 million people milling about with nothing to do. They need to reconstruct, but with what? The nations that define the currencies of the past, in certain cases like Germany, they didn't exist anymore. So the Western nations basically got together and, to give confidence, said, here's a piece of gold. You all know what that is. We're going to abstract it. It's not a Bitcoin, but there's going to be 35 US dollars to that ounce of gold. And each of these US dollars you can reference as a mark or a pound or a lira. Gentlemen, start your engine. So it was all kind of subjective. The dollar got displaced from the gold standard by the petrodollar. As we move forward into the Industrial Revolution, as productivity became one that was based on oil because of machinery, nations that had capital surplus because they were productive could essentially secure their productivity future by storing oil. But rather than storing oil, you would just store a dollar. So if you could accumulate US dollars because oil was transacted with dollars, you could secure your economic future. So we became a world of petrodollars in a very concentrated sense for this very short period of time, literally of less than 100 years. So let's look at the 100-year period that we're in now relative to the 400,000, 500,000, 300,000, whatever the period of humanity has been, or the civilized humanity of, you know, several thousand years. For most of that period, humans didn't live in top-down centralized structures. They didn't work in top-down centralized structures. If you were a caveman, you might decide in the morning to go pick berries with five friends. In the mid-morning, you might go fish with six others. In the evening, you might go hunt with seven others. So your job was a function of what you wanted to do, when you wanted to do it, and it was inspiration-based. Only for 1.5 generations, typically your parents, and maybe part of the generation of their parents, were companies organized in the Industrial Revolution high capital intensity model, where he who controlled capital controlled marginal economic productivity. So those that controlled the might of the Industrial Revolution were able to take humans and commoditize them and make them like little hamsters on wheels doing one function and promise them lifetime employment and promise them pensions for the rest of their lives. That's turned out to be a fantasy that maybe shouldn't have ever existed. So I think we've gone through a couple generations where we thought civilization was sort of like this and it step functioned into a new model. That might have just been a blip. So now we're basically going back because of software where every one of you in the room here is like a molecule sitting on an extended fabric of humanity. You can virtualize, come off the page, connect with other people of similar interests, and become your own virtual nation. So what Jason, I'll close out with, you know, what Jason talked about this earlier today about government as a service, e-service. I think blockchain is going to be bigger than the Silicon Wave or the kind of the internet wave, both in kind of magnitude of what it's transacting, but also in the redefinition of society. If you think about what government should be, it should be a service to the people. You'll be able to basically have virtual nations, and Taiwan is a perfect example of that. There are so many overseas Chinese that originally are from Taiwan. You could effectively create a blockchain-based government system where it's service to a virtual nation, borderless, independent. I live in America. I could still be a Taiwanese citizen fully serviced by the e-services here. So I'll just close with that. We're on the front of a big transformational wave. So thank you very much for your time.